Hi, everyone. Welcome to our Cultivating Talent from Within session. I'm Jessie Permar-Kelly, the Senior Director for Rebuilding Together's National AmeriCorps program. I have worked with AmeriCorps members and supervisors for 8 years now, coaching both sides through both the challenges and the high points that come with an AmeriCorps term of service. Over the years, I have learned a lot about how to coach both supervisors and AmeriCorps members to reach their full potential and reach their full potential with each other in their respective roles, help them work more smoothly together, communicate more openly, and successfully resolve the challenges that come up. So today, I'm really excited to share some of the best practices that I have gathered along the way, and sometimes just blatantly stolen from others, whole hog. So I'm excited to share some of these ideas and tips with you for working with many different people in many different styles and scenarios to really be able to reach their full potential and resolve any challenges. So I'd like to begin by just going over our agenda. So this is, of course, Cultivating Talent from Within. The idea being how you can both develop a pipeline of leadership within your organization, whether you're looking at AmeriCorps or staff, but then also to help each individual reach their own potential within themselves to be the best version of themselves personally and professionally. So we're going to get into a little bit of supervision and coaching, knowing thyself as a supervisor and getting to know your AmeriCorps members and your supervisees, and then a bit about some practical tools you can use to communicate either in normal life or as you're getting into a particular performance or behavior challenge. And then wrapping up with making sure that you as a supervisor are taking care of yourself as well. This session is all about how you can do the most for your supervisee and help them, achieve their full potential. But you also want to be looking out for yourself as a supervisor and making sure that you are also doing well and doing okay. So to begin, I have a brief thought exercise. So if you'd like a little bit more time, I'm not going to spend a ton of time on this slide, but if you'd like a little more time, feel free to pause your recording to give yourself a chance to really think about this. So take a minute to think about who in your career was the best supervisor that you've ever had? What made them great for you particularly? And if it helps, you can jot this down. And then after a minute, think about who was the worst supervisor you've ever had. Hopefully not someone you're working with currently. But think about, what made it a little bit harder to work with that person. So you're not necessarily going to do anything with this during the session. It's just past participants have given me the feedback that it's useful to just have a person or a couple of people in mind to apply some of these concepts to. So don't stress about it, but if you'd like, feel free to pause and take a moment to consider. With your best and worst supervisors in mind, let's go ahead and dive right in. There has been actually a lot of thought and research done by a lot of different individuals and organizations on different supervision and management styles. I feel like if you're attending a session like this, you're probably familiar with some of them, or at least the idea of them. There are lots of approaches out there that might resonate with you. This is the one that has stuck with me and that I have found over the years has been the most accessible by different AmeriCorps supervisors and members. So it's the one I'll be sharing today. It considers supervision and supervision style along a spectrum from a purely supervision approach to a purely coaching approach. And we'll get into each of those ends of the spectrum now. So with the purely supervisory approach, this is much more task-oriented. You're kind of like building the road as you go along with your supervisee from day to day. You're assigning tasks, you're setting the agenda, you're telling them what to do. The supervisor is kind of in charge of the relationship they own, in a sense, the work being done by the supervisee. Like that, this even the supervisee's work is a direct reflection of themselves as a supervisor. And the supervisor sets the specific standard that the supervisee must meet without a lot of discussion or input from the supervisee. A purely coaching approach is a lot more open-ended. And in some cases, it can feel a little bit unstructured, especially for a new person, a new supervisee. A 100% coaching approach to supervision looks at it as more of a peer-to-peer relationship. And they value the supervisee's experience almost as much as the work product itself. I'll say that both sides have their merits, but you can probably tell that I'm about to advocate for a middle of the road approach, as well as learning how to move up and down that spectrum as needed for your particular supervisee, your particular AmeriCorps member, and your relationship with them. By adapting a style that pulls from the best of both supervision and coaching, you're able to create an environment of safe risks for the supervisee to take on more responsibility and more independence within the kind of the scaffolding that you as the supervisor are building around them to take those safe risks. The idea is to resist their urge to immediately start dictating the exact parameters of the project. This is exactly what you must do. These are the exact steps, et cetera, et cetera. But instead, to ask your supervisee to engage in some critical thinking first. What are your recommendations for how to solve this challenge? What did you think of that event? What did you want to keep? What do you want to change for next time? And an approach like this puts more ownership on your supervisee. It lets them practice finding the solution for themselves. And it also lets you hear their answer, and then you can assess their understanding of a project or situation. If you're just telling them and then sending them on their way, you as the supervisor aren't really tapped into like how they're interpreting the information and how they're going to put it into practice. But if you're having them tell you and set to you the goals and the criteria of the project, then you've got that back and forth as a supervisor and you can help refine. So once they have kind of communicated to you, here's what I think the assignment is, here's what I think success looks like. You can ask more questions of them and then give your own feedback. You're not throwing them into the deep end by themselves, but you're providing that structure and that scaffolding for them to learn and to get more comfortable working more independently. So that would be the blended supervision plus coaching approach. By adopting a more healthy balance of coaching and supervision, you're making a long-term investment in your supervisee, your AmeriCorps member, and in your larger organization. Supervisees are, you know, taking on more independence, more responsibilities. They're gaining confidence, hopefully, and you're putting them on a path to advance within your organization. If you see your AmeriCorps members as potentially someday joining your staff. Or if not, for many AmeriCorps members, you know, they're kind of inherently with us on a medium-term basis. But even so, as an AmeriCorps host site, we want to do as much as we can for AmeriCorps members to use this experience as a springboard onto the next phase of their career. So even if you yourself and your own organization won't see the benefits of coaching this person to their full potential, that's what we should be doing anyway as AmeriCorps host sites and supervisors. And I do love the fact that this approach sets up a pipeline of leadership within your own organization. I'm really proud to say that my own organization, Rebuilding Together, hires a lot of AmeriCorps members, even if there's not a position within their own host site. Coming from an AmeriCorps with Rebuilding Together background is a huge benefit to if there's another open position elsewhere around the country. And I would like to think that our approach to AmeriCorps as like, let's seize this opportunity and get the most out of it. I'd like to think that that has a little something to do with it, but probably the AmeriCorps members themselves deserve most of the credit for that. Okay, so in addition, supervisees are less dependent on their supervisors and can resolve these bigger and more complex challenges on their own without having to be as reliant on their supervisor. And if you're ensuring that communication is going both ways, that it's not just going from supervisor to supervisee as a directive, you as a supervisor, like I mentioned, will have a lot more nuanced understanding of the member's own grasp of their role and their own competence in their role. The more information you have, the more you as a supervisor can do to help your supervisees address any challenge areas within themselves and continue to grow. And as weird as it sounds, stepping back to give your supervisees more independence and more ownership actually gives you as a supervisor more control, because it means that you're adopting this kind of firm but flexible foundation and kind of seat in yourself as a supervisor. And you can take on, I'll say almost, any supervisee that comes your way. This is incredibly important for supervisors, especially of AmeriCorps members, because turnover is a pretty inherent part of an AmeriCorps program. And over the years, I have worked with different supervisors who can only really be successful if they get the right person, if there's just that natural fit, because that supervisor isn't necessarily as agile and as fluent in being able to work with people of different personality types, unfortunately. And to me, as the national program director, to me, that's a risk factor for that host site, is that success is really reliant on finding the right person for that host site. It puts a lot of pressure on recruitment, but it also puts the supervisor kind of, how to say, like, at the mercy, sounds bad. But essentially, you know, you're relying on a couple of interviews to figure out if this person is the right fit. And if your supervisory toolkit is kind of sparse, you can only really access your supervisee's current exact skill level rather than being able to help them grow and access more of their potential. So we're talking about becoming more versatile and more fluent as a supervisor and a leader to lead people of different styles. But how do you know as a supervisor exactly how much support and structure versus freedom or ownership that your new AmeriCorps member is going to need? Everybody's going to start in a different place. Some will have a kind of a head start. Others will be, you know, starting from square one, and in either way is fine, because this approach will help you move people along this continuum from a purely directing approach, AKA supervisory approach, to a more coaching, developing approach on the right side of your screen with that blue arrow. So this shows the continuum. I would say for a new person, it's always better to be more merciful and to start by giving them a little bit more answers than questions, right? Like if you've got a new person, start with a more directing approach. You'd also do that for someone who is struggling a little bit in their competence. Maybe they are uncertain and just need a little bit more support. So for these folks, you'd want to use a directing approach. And the next slide will tell you a little bit more information about what that actually looks like. So as your AmeriCorps member or your supervisee gains more experience and more competence, as you get to know them better and their skill level better, you'd advance them along the continuum to a delegation approach, and then finally to the development approach. The one exception would be for an emergency. When your stress level is high, when critical decisions need to be made fast on the spur of the moment, it's probably better in many cases for you to revert back to that director mode. You may not want to take the time to kind of like thoughtfully guide someone through a decision-making process. And that's fine. You can see a little bit more detail about each of the three approaches on the screen in the different arrows. In the directing approach, you as a supervisor are still providing a clear, detailed picture of what success looks like for each project. You're giving a couple of steps at a time for the supervisee to complete before your next check-in. You want lots of check-ins, more oversight on how your supervisee is doing on each step. So with every step, you're checking in to see how they did and give feedback. And again, as they gain confidence and skill, you're giving more of the project all at once. You are asking them in a more coaching way to give you their idea of success and the steps that they want to take rather than providing that detail yourself. And then if you're identifying a problem that they're not seeing, you would use your questions, which we'll talk more about later, to guide them through the solution, guide them towards the solution. And then finally, when someone is fully capable and fully confident of their own ability, which is just such a wonderful moment for all involved, you would move to the final development kind of supervisory mindset. Essentially, you're making them aware that they are assigned this particular project. You are just hearing from them, like, what's your vision? What are your priorities for this project? Confirming they're on the right track. And then you let them do their thing. You're checking in a lot more rarely than you would in the directing approach. And a quick note, you might find that one supervisee, one AmeriCorps member, can be at multiple different stages along this continuum for different projects. So someone may be fully developing in a certain area, but when you add especially a brand new, more critical, more stressful project, you would want to kind of revert back to your earlier phases until they get comfortable again. Okay, quick pause for another thought exercise, another moment of reflection. The next section is going to be talking a bit about how each of us can be quite different and bring different things to the table as professionals and workers, but still being able to appreciate and leverage the advantages that are found by having a diverse team. So that's where we're going next. But in the meantime, take a moment and consider when in your own career you felt that you were just the best supervisee to work with. What made you the most successful in kind of managing that supervisor-supervisee relationship and fulfilling what your supervisor was looking for? And then next, when in your career were you maybe not the best supervisor you've ever been? And what made you maybe a little harder to work with? And if you like, you can take a minute, jot some things down, take a minute to reflect. But again, these are just to have some examples to hold in your mind as you're going through the presentation. And then lastly, what made you change? Assuming that you are not still the worst supervisee you've ever been, spend a little bit reflecting on like what made you grow in advance in your own career, moving from worst to hopefully best supervisee you've ever been. Okay, so take a moment here, feel free to pause. All right, with those examples in mind, I'm actually gonna use an example from my own early career when I was certainly not the best supervisee I could have ever been, to illustrate one example of how considering yourself, your own style, your supervisee and their style, considering both you and the other person in that relationship as unique individuals with their own strengths, their own hangups, etc. So supervision, I'll say, unfortunately, is not a one-size-fits-all equation. There's no one approach to supervision that's the magic key that's going to unlock or work with every single person equally successfully. That's just not how it works, unfortunately, or at least as far as I have seen. Instead, it's crucial really to get to know yourself and your style first so that you can learn how to better adjust your style for the needs of your supervisee. And as the supervisor, that's kind of your role. You're the one that needs to Well, as you're coaching your supervisee to gain skill and competence in deliver a work product that you think looks good, you as a supervisor also should be thinking about how, you know, in my role in this relationship is also to try to adjust and provide supervision that's a good fit for this person as well. So understanding that first step and becoming fluent in someone else's style and helping them grow in a way that's actually meaningful and realistic for them is key as a supervisor. So on to my moment of vulnerability. I was fired from my first real job, which was a part-time gig at my local library when I was in high school. I will say it was kind of devastating at the time and really stuck with me for a long, long time, even, you know, not quite to this day, but for a while. And I have actually learned a lot by reflecting on that experience and really understanding and dissecting kind of what went down and what could have done better, what I could have done better. And I think I've learned a lot. So you just did a thought experiment where you thought about how you grew and changed from being maybe a tough supervisee to hopefully a better supervisee in whatever your role is now. And when you were thinking about what made you change and grow to become more skilled, I would imagine that a lot of you are remembering a time where you may have completely flubbed a job. Hopefully not as thoroughly as in my example, but you're probably, a lot of you are thinking about a time that was really hard for you in your career. And I feel like that's something that's going to be pretty common. The most experience happens in hardship rather than in necessarily when things are going well. Let's see. And I would say it is important for us as supervisors, especially when many AmeriCorps members are early in their careers, young professionals, it's kind of important to keep that in mind, that the most growth tends to come from the most struggle. And it's important for us to see that, especially if we are working with an AmeriCorps member who is themselves struggling a little bit. All right, so on to the example. At the library in high school, just a reminder, high school, long time ago, I had two responsibilities. The first was to take patron information from their super old paper card catalog system and to input that information into the new computer system. The other was to reshelve books the minute a patron brought the book back to the library after checking it out. I was to take the books and put them back on the stacks. So my supervisor basically wanted me to stop inputting the patron info every time a book came back, walk it back to the stacks individually as soon as the patron returned it. In my infinite late teenage wisdom, I felt like it would be a better use of time to return the books when we had kind of accumulated a couple. And I was pretty sure that my supervisor was going to see the light eventually. I'm sure I was lovely to work with. I was too shy at that time to really explain myself. And my boss never really, I think, took the time to ask why was I not getting her instructions and her expectations. We parted ways eventually. I would say I don't think either my supervisor or I at the time had a very good sense of communication styles, workplace styles at that point. I myself, for sure, did not have enough appreciation for the value that other perspectives or other styles bring to the workplace and to life in general. I only really knew of one way, which was my own way. And if somebody wasn't like completely meshing with that, then it was kind of like, well, you're not as good at being me as I am. So maybe you should work on that. So that was kind of my approach at that time, before I was able to really understand that actually there are a lot of different approaches and each of them bring their own value. And I think the first step for me in kind of
awakening to this new world, was to gain a vocabulary for articulating about how these styles and values could be different. So having the vocabulary came first, and then that helped inform my understanding. So one of my favorite approaches and my favorite kind of set of vocabulary came to me through the Platinum Rule, which I'll get into more in a moment. It's essentially an approach to business style and communication style that says, instead of following the Golden Rule, which is treat everyone the way you want to be treated, that did not go well for me. Instead, the Platinum Rule is to treat others the way they want to be treated. And that relies on really, really knowing them and understanding them and what they need to feel supported and successful. And so in the Platinum Rule, they do lay out these four main personality types and how these types approach their work and interact in the workplace. So to give you an example, in hindsight, I feel like my supervisor might have, really felt like the library's purpose is to just have the most content available to patrons at all times. And if that meant that the process was not the most efficient, so be it. But in her mind, like, this is what a library is all about. So that's our goal. So these were the values that she was bringing to the exchange and to her own approach. Or maybe she felt like the more opportunities that the staff had to get up and interact with the patrons, the better, rather than being kind of isolated behind the desk. The staff are all up and about all the time, interacting, asking questions, and just being visible. Or maybe she wanted patrons to have a friendly and welcoming atmosphere, where, again, the staff was very visible, and there was a lot of connection and a lot of relationship building between staff and patrons to create that atmosphere that draws people in and makes a library a kind of a community hub, again, rather than the staff being isolated behind the circulation desk all the time. And then there's what at that time was my original kind of perspective on this. Libraries are understaffed all the time. And as nonprofit leaders, this will sound familiar to us. We've got limited staff time. And so we should be as intentional with our approach as we can, because we want to offer as many services. We want to meet as many needs as we can. So these are how the Platinum Rule, the different personality types, might apply to my particular library situation. So take a second to just sit back and reflect on your own reactions as you were hearing me read out these options. Did any of these different colored squares resonate with you in particular, where you're like, yes, that's me. I feel like that would be the right approach. Or did any of them stand out to you as kind of like a waste of time, or like, it's a filler, you got to have four types, so you got to add one in there, or just like, would be nice, but that's not the priority. So think about which one were you instantly drawn to, and which one you kind of like, no, that one's not for me. So pick the one that you resonated with, and keep your eye on the square through the next couple of slides, because I'm going to show a couple of examples of different celebrities and fictional characters. Oh, that's a GIF. Okay. Very interesting. So we're going to go through a couple that line up, with each of the four types. So again, I would say for my own approach here, we need the most efficient process to meet patron needs. I'm positing that Agent Scully from X-Files would match with that the most. All right. So in the live session and in the group discussion board, we're going to get a little bit more into these four personality types, the advantages and the challenges that each bring with them to the workplace, both as supervisors and as supervisees. You yourself have a personality and a mindset that you bring to the table. In the meantime, here's a few hopefully known to you people and characters that will line up with these four different types and help kind of give you a picture in your mind to get through the rest of this session, because I'm not going to talk about these in much more detail during this recorded session. So again, keep your eye on the squares and I'll keep going along. How about this one? Do you feel like you're relating to the person in your square the most out of these four? Or do you feel like it's maybe missing the mark for you? And either way is fine. And I will say, you will notice, yes, I did make a very bold move by picking President Obama's square as the one that aligned with myself. That's my prerogative as a presenter. Feel free to assign him elsewhere for your own presentation on cultivating talent from within. Okay. Gotta have some perks to be the presenter, you know. All right, so under the platinum rule, they are calling their four personality types relators, socializers, thinkers, and directors. There are a lot of quizzes out there that will assign you to one of the four boxes, to one of four boxes. They'll have different names, slightly different variations, but you know, if you've done a lot of these, you'll see some similarities. I'm not necessarily arguing that platinum rule is a special unicorn all of its own. The important thing, if you feel like your own vocabulary could be widened, the important thing is to find one that resonates with you and that can kind of unlock this perspective for you, rather than seeing that one of these tests are going to be the word of law. This is the one right way to approach it. That's not the case. Humans are way more complicated than that. This is just a framework that you can use to you know, kind of start to get fluent in other personality styles. And I do like the platinum rule. For me, the platinum rule is the best because it does give you some very specific frameworks for putting these concepts into action and to actually improve your relationships with people of different work styles. So it'll say, you know, are you having a difficult time relating with your supervisor who is a socializer, or your supervisee who is a director? Like, here are certain things that can help you become more fluent in their style. And perhaps it's because I myself identify as a thinker, but that approach resonates with me. So find one that works for you and go with it. Okay. So again, take a step back to think about the other, you know, the totality of the four boxes. What are your feelings about the other three boxes as well? How would you feel if your boss was Bob Ross? Would you love him but be slowly driven insane by his calmness and just kind of relax, laissez-faire nature? Or would that work really well for you? Do you feel like you would really vibe with that as someone who is your boss, who you need for structure and support? What if you had to supervise Judge Judy? Are you like, absolutely, bring it on, let's do this, that sounds amazing? Or maybe you're feeling a little intimidated by the idea of working with someone who is so different from you. I would say, without an understanding of the different styles, without a framework to communicate your needs in the language of the other style, it's pretty easy to feel discouraged that you'll ever be able to connect with that person. And it can be easy also to be dismissive of the other person and say, well, they're just difficult. They're impossible. I can't work with them. And I would say both of those are red herrings. It is actually possible. It is possible to communicate with people that are different from you and to work better with them. It just takes a little practice and a little fluency. So we're going to get more specific with these styles in the live session. But in the meantime, I'm asking that you try to take the awareness of style, add it to your kind of supervisory arsenal as we move into the next section, which is how to ask good questions. So normally we would start with the personality styles and layer the questions section on top of that. These two things these two topics, personality styles, how to ask good questions, they're interlaced. normally, but we're going to do it a little backwards. So just asking you to bear in mind, style does influence questions and vice versa. So combining that style fluency and the ability to ask these great questions is pretty crucial for being able to supervise anyone, get the best out of anyone, not just working with someone who's already on your exact wavelength or has the same exact expectations of how your supervisor relationship will work. If you're already exactly on the same page and exactly in sync, that's amazing. But you can't always count on that in the workplace, unfortunately. I'll add that understanding style and asking questions is also useful to managing up to your own supervisor, maybe, to getting along well with family and friends, too. There's a lot of applications to this. But for now, let's not go too crazy. Let's keep it focused on how you can work best with your supervisee in the workplace. So as we explore the subject of how to ask questions to build strong, open communication, we'll get into why, you know, this is a slightly longer approach. It's a little bit of a detour through the woods. It's not the direct line. The fastest, directest line is your supervisee comes to you with a question, you answer the question. That's the fastest, most direct way to resolve the issue of supervisee needs information. I have given them the information. Goodbye. That's the fastest. Taking a time out to coach them through finding the solution themselves is that detour. So why is that worth your time in the long term? Why do this to yourself and to them? So we're going to talk about making the time. We're going to talk about how to set up good questions, how to use them to get the outcome that you want. And then we'll also quickly talk about how to know if your questions are really landing and being successful, getting you where you want to go. Like we talked about, Up at the top of this session, in the coaching section, if you're always telling your supervisee what to do and exactly how to do it, you're not in a listening mindset, and you're training your supervisee essentially that they are very reliant on you for the answer. You're not challenging them to think critically, and you're probably not as in tune as you could be to any concerns or any uncertainty that your supervisee might have. You're delivering the information. You're relying on them to know if they should need to ask questions, to feel confident enough to ask questions. And that can lead to some issues down the road if your supervisee is not great at, especially if your supervisee is not great at advocating for themselves. We're all busy. I think this is probably the biggest challenge of supervisors that I have seen across the board is making time to take this like slightly circuitous route, because it's long-term investment. Like short-term, it's going to make your day a little longer. It might be a little more frustrating, but it is worth it in the long-term. So the thing that I see is like the biggest stumbling block for supervisors is like, thinking about your hierarchy of needs. I don't have time for this long-term stuff right now. And then when you add supervision into it, like you're even more pressured. But just to say like that's, it might be saving you a couple minutes today, but it could add a lot more work onto your plate down the road. And then again, you're investing in yourself and your own future happiness. As your supervisee gets more independent, and less dependent on you specifically, the more time you'll have long run. But it is hard to get in that discipline now, I will admit. So a question inherently demands an answer. It demands that both you and your supervisee pause and ensure that an actual two-way street of communication has actually taken place, that you have actually been heard and not just listened to by your supervisee, and vice versa, right? Like if you're just telling, the information's only going one way. You need it to go both ways. the way you ask a question will determine whether you get a useful answer from your supervisee that's like moving them along this continuum towards independence, or whether you'll get a frustrating answer that makes you want to pull your hair out. People aren't usually trying to be cagey. They're not trying to irritate you. They just are not hearing the question in the same way that you intended it. So you may need to adjust the way you are asking your questions to actually get on the same wavelength. So here's a few ways that you can do that. Try a couple of different question formats. Again, you want to try the different formats to get the kind of answer you want, thus the kind of critical thinking you want. So for example, a closed question will get you a yes or a no. Sometimes you want a yes or a no, but sometimes you want to open a discussion so that you can have that two-way conversation. So for example, instead of saying, did you complete the project, which is a very closed-ended question, go with, how did the project go? What went well? What could be better? What do you want to keep for next time, right? So you're moving it to more open-ended, and the way you've asked that question demands something more that you can't just say, how did the project go? Yes, it went. Like that's not how conversations work usually. So you can also try moving up and down the spectrum of specificity as well to kind of unlock those mental connections. So you could ask, how many volunteers did we get this year as opposed to last year? That's a very specific question. And that can be a hard question to answer. So if your supervisee is panicked and struggling at that question, try instead moving it to be more general, more analytical, like how did we do compared to last year? So the former might cause your supervisee to panic because they don't have those exact numbers in front of them. And it also doesn't spur them to actually think about it. They're just reciting memorized information, whereas the latter actually gets your supervisee to think like, oh, what does that mean? Like how did we do compared to last year? What is better? What is improvement in terms of volunteer number? You know what I mean? Like it's a different kind of critical thinking question. And then you can also move general to specific to make the conversation go along more smoothly. Your supervisee might get frustrated with a more specific question, or they might have been waiting for weeks for you to ask them that particular question because they would love to like pull out their numbers and show you everything on their spreadsheet. And it's amazing and you're so proud of them, but also you're dying inside because you have 10 other things you need to do to like in the next hour. So just figure out how to ask questions to get the right amount of critical thinking and sharing that you might want. And then on the flip side, just a quick note, like your different personality style might make you more open or more understanding of a different kind of question. So thinkers, directors, your specific questions might like really like kind of resonate with them. And then also if you are a supervisor who is a thinker, you might also find yourself tending to ask really specific questions that cause your non-thinker supervisees to freak out and like, oh God, like I don't think of that way. You know, so you also want to be mindful of your own style and the style of your supervisees as a clue for how to adjust your questions to have a really productive conversation. And then two, be mindful your supervisee is going to be asking you questions in an ideal world. So your thinker supervisees, again, might ask you some very particular questions. Consider, they're probably not trying to quiz you or trip you up. That's just part of their personality and part of how they really understand things is that they have to understand every part of it. That can be a little daunting as a supervisor. So be aware of that, and then be aware of, your own tendencies. Are you also someone who tends to have a conversation that feels like a nice interrogation, but still a little bit of an interrogation, right? So like be mindful of those dynamics as well. All right. Mm-mm-mm. Let's see. So we talked about moving general to specific. or like being able to move to a more general question to help with communication. A situation where you might want to move to more specific question is like if you want to kind of debrief about a particular event, you want to narrow down your question. Instead of saying, how do you like working with clients? How's that going? Instead, you know, say, how was your interaction with Mr. Jones the other day? How did that go? You know, like you want to narrow it down if you need to debrief perhaps a Mr. Jones related incident from the other day. Help your supervisee read your mind. If your question kind of hits them weirdly, reconsider how you phrase it to get the answer you're looking for. And as it shows on the screen, I have a particular fondness for anything else you want to talk about, any other business, anything else on your mind. That really helps at the end of a one-on-one to just make sure that, you know, you're not omnipotent as much as a supervisor, as much as you'd like to be. So this also helps create an opportunity for you to not be omnipotent and all seeing, like your supervisee can bring a topic of into the conversation as well. Right. And then lastly, you want to think about direct versus indirect, how direct to be, when to be more indirect. I would say never put something as a question when what you really want to do is a command. So shouldn't you be sending that email is not going to hit well. That your supervisee is going to interpret that probably as a little passive aggressive. Instead, say, hey, you know, just a reminder to send that email that we talked about. A command doesn't have to be harsh and scary, but like that's where you would want to be a little bit more direct instead of trying to soften it by making it a question. And, you know, like earlier I was talking about thinkers can be very specific with their questions. That's their tendency. Relators and socializers, you might tend more to softening things and turning things into questions that can prickle your supervisee in a way that you don't mean it to, right? So just be careful to overcompensate into too many questions when a question is not what's really needed. So if you, let's see. There are going to be times where you will want to use a questioning approach to help someone think through something that didn't go so well. You know, if as a first step, you know, we're not talking about like the nuclear option catastrophe. We're just talking about kind of course correcting and getting people right back on the right track when it's not a big deal just yet, but you want to be proactive about getting people back on track, right? So the first step to that, again, like make sure you're ready to move on to a solution. Make sure you're not coming from a place of frustration, a place where you want to maybe yell at someone instead of helping them find the answer. So you can use questions, if you've got that mindset going for you, you can use questions to help someone get from a problem to a solution. And starting with, you know, especially when you're a little frustrated when something has gone wrong, you may have the instinct to say, okay, well, they got it wrong, so I need to provide them with the answer. And that's not always the case. Rather than defaulting to giving them your opinion or your prepackaged solution, use questions to help your supervisee have a chance to put it in their own words first. Chances are that they, you know, the minute a mistake was made, they're like, oh crap, like I know exactly why that wasn't a good idea. So let them have a chance to show that they have learned and to show that they realize what went wrong and to show that, you know, they're able to fix it. I think that's a much more respectful and empowering position to put your supervisee into rather than you're just immediately, well, you ruined it, so now I need to step in and show you what's what, you know. And again, it takes a little longer, but it's worth it in the long run. And then especially like getting them involved in setting the direction of the solution. That helps them be more invested in working on that solution if they feel like it was at least partially their idea. You might be thinking to yourself, well, they've already made a mistake once. Like, what happens if they're not in that ideal situation? Like, if they're not already moving into the right solution, that's fine too. You can use your questions to form a dialogue and to help them course correct again. If they're not already there, you can help them get those last few steps. So instead of saying, that idea will not work because of X, you didn't think of X, you're horrible. Don't say that. Instead, try, how would you handle X, right? Like, you're bringing it to their attention and you're making them have the critical thinking of resolving it. Worst case scenario, they come to the realization that their bad idea was bad on their own. and then you don't have to be the one to kill it. Or best case, like, maybe they have a creative solution that you had never thought of to address X, and like, good thing you didn't kill it, because now they're going to innovate a little bit and try something new. Right. One last thought about this topic of questions and how to use them to your advantage is how to know when you've gone far enough versus when it's time to give it a rest. When is too many questions? So you can, of course, try different kinds of questions, ask more questions if you're not getting the information you really need or want. If their answers start getting vague, or if it's more of an excuse rather than a dialogue, and they're kind of, you can feel them resisting the lure into the dialogue with you, into the solution process with you, if you feel excuses, like these little barriers being put up, your supervisory spidey senses should be tingling. That this is a path you should probably walk a little further down. Like, usually resistance is there for a reason, and you want to gently explore that a bit. But of course, when I say gentle, I mean make sure your questions and the dialogue is still solution focused rather than punishing. Not what were you thinking, instead, like, how did that go? And like, what would you like to change and work on for next time? Always, like, respect is number one, no matter the situation, unless they've done something unbelievably egregious. Like, you should always be respectful in your approach to your supervisees, because you want to be mindful of the power dynamic and just how that's very visible to your supervisees. And it's easy for us as supervisors to forget the power dynamic and forget our responsibility to create a space of safety, even when dealing with a challenge. If someone gets upset, especially if that someone is you, that is a moment to take a break. Do not keep pushing through frustration and somebody's kind of emotional breakdown. There's always time in the future to come back to this. It might help if you feel someone's getting towards being upset, make sure that they know, like, we're just talking about one particular piece of the puzzle. This is not the entire puzzle. Overall, big picture, like, you as a supervisee are doing really well. Don't let this one incident kind of change your entire identity here. Like, we're just wanting to fine tune this one piece. So reconnect them with the bigger picture of their performance and their competence. Okay. So wrapping up this topic, be merciful to your new hires, go easy on them early in their role. As much as you are training your supervisees in their role, you also want to train them how to manage up to you, how to get what they need to be successful on the occasions when you are maybe not operating at full supervisory superhero status. There are going to be times when you're busy or distracted, and you want them to feel comfortable hitting you over the head and saying, hey, I need this. Like, do this for me, please. Because if they're not comfortable doing that, like, that's, again, like, I guarantee you that will be a problem for, it will become your problem down the road. So better to make sure that communication, again, is a two-way street from the beginning. So you want to train them to ask you questions, especially, not just the other way around. So you make sure you have good habits, even acknowledge this, like articulate this as a strategy to your supervisees, have a little meta, like breaking the fourth wall commentary about how questions are really important and you want them to be able to come to you with questions. You see your role as a thought partner, not as the decider in the law. You want to remove any of those barriers to that open flow of communication as possible. One-on-one meetings are a great way of doing that. You're removing that barrier to entry. There's always time set aside, no matter how small the question, how small the concern. You want your supervisees to bring that to you. You don't want them to say, it's just dumb, it's fine. Because especially early on, like they don't necessarily have the experience to know what might snowball down the road. So let them bring their smaller questions to you. That's really important. And then it's making sure that you have those meetings, no matter how busy you get. That's one of the best things you can do to building trust and to building a solid relationship. If things get rough later on, you're both going to need that trust and that established relationship and understanding to get through any tough times. And then, of course, call them out if they're gently, again, call them out if they're not asking you questions, if they're not challenging you on things. You want them to feel more comfortable, like breaking down those traditional barriers. So you could do something like assigning them to bring three questions to every single check-in. Let them know that you expect it so that they are not embarrassed or guilty of wasting your time or in their own mind wasting your time by asking you things. All right, moving along. Our second to last section is going to dig a little deeper into some of the trickier challenges that we face as supervisors, which is something bigger has happened and we need to have a capital C conversation. Every conversation about poor performance or something that went wrong, a bigger mistake that was made, you as the supervisor should put as much of your heart and soul into viewing it as an opportunity to get someone back on the right track as you can. If you come into it fed up or that you want to punish someone, or you just want to vent your frustrations on them, you might be right. Like I'm not saying you're wrong to feel that way. You're a human being as much as your supervisee. You're allowed to have these emotions. But if you bring all of that with you to this conversation, it's often going to set up this self-fulfilling prophecy. Like your supervisee can tell whether you are invested in them in bad times as well as good times. And they will take their cues from you about how hard they're going to try to fix things. If you're showing that you believe in them, sometimes you might need to fake it till you make it on that one. But if you are communicating the message of you can do this and we're going to figure this out, they're much more likely to actually be able to achieve it. Whereas if you're not sending those messages, it's probably going to be a rough road ahead. Okay. Before you begin, like I mentioned, you want to take stock of your own emotional state as you go into it. And you want to really take a time to step back and really consider what exactly is going wrong that needs to be addressed. The surface problem is usually just that there's actually something deeper going on that never gets addressed with surface level solutions. You need to think deeper, otherwise you're going to have the same conversation over and over again. So signs that might point to this is if you feel like you're talking about the same thing over and over again, and you're more and more frustrated, even if the problem is still the same every time, like the problem isn't getting worse, it's the same thing, but your frustration level is getting up and up and up, that's a sign that maybe think deeper. So for example, if your supervisee is showing up late and unprepared for your first meeting, and that, you know, it's the same amount of lateness, it's the same level of unpreparedness, the first time, you know, talk about, like, address it while it's not a big deal, while it's a one-time thing. Don't ignore it, but also don't beat them up over it. Just make sure that they understand that that was not, they need to do something different. But if it keeps happening after that conversation, then it's not really about the lateness anymore. Now it's about the fact that you and they had agreed that they were going to do better, and they're not keeping to their own commitment. It's a pattern of behavior now. And so when you're having these conversations, you need to talk about the pattern, not just the lateness, right? That's what keeps it from being the same conversation over and over again. And then, after you've had your second conversation, let's say it happens again. it does happen. Again, you want to escalate even more. Now it's not just the lateness. It's not just that they didn't keep their commitment. Now it's having an impact on your ability to trust them to fulfill their commitments, to trust them to pull their weight on the team. And that, you as a supervisor, you feel like they're not really respecting your concerns and what you're asking them to do. These are just examples. It might not be spot on to your exact situation, but hopefully it's modeling how to not keep having that same conversation over and over again. And it models how sometimes you have to draw a line. You have to make it clear what the impact that their actions are having on other people, because they may not be able to see it themselves directly, right? So again, that's your prep work. What is the actual issue, and do I need to be talking about the incident, the pattern, or the relationship? Okay. As the supervisor and the person with all the power, you're the one who's doing the confronting. That's an extra layer of power. It's your responsibility to make sure you're creating a safe environment to have a difficult conversation. Don't be rushed. Don't be stressed. Talk in private. And then you yourself have to be solution focused at the start. So start with the solution, and frame it in a way that's respectful and beneficial to you both. So start with a goal and frame the conversation with a respectful and mutually beneficial goal. So I want to talk about being on time and prepared for the day ahead. Going from 0 to 60 first thing in the morning is stressful for everybody. And I want to work together on a way to make mornings less stressful. That's a great way to describe the situation above as a mutually beneficial goal. From there, in neutral terms, describe the gap between your expectations and what is actually happening. We work in a hectic environment and things change all the time. We have our first thing in the morning meetings to make sure everybody has the most up-to-date information and we can all hit the ground running. I've noticed a few days recently where you were a little late. You didn't have your updates ready to share with the group. This caused a bit of confusion with the other staff. They didn't know what to focus on and what their next steps were. They had to wait for your updates later, and that put a delay and a confusion that kind of snowballed for the rest of that day, right? Notice that this is all about facts. It's nothing about them as a person or nothing about their personality, and it didn't make any assumptions about why the situation was happening. So an example of a bad approach would be, you think your time is more important than anyone else's and it's starting to be a problem. That's, emotionally true for you maybe, but it's not neutral, it's not factual. And if you bring that to your supervisee, they're going to want to defend themselves and get into a conversation about their intention, whether or not they intended to hurt anyone. And, that's not the problem you want to talk about. You want to get a beeline straight to be on time and be prepared, right? Recognize that sometimes your own emotionality can be a red herring luring you both down the wrong path. Okay. Quick note about not trying to, plan out every possible scenario you could run into. If you are not used to having these conversations, if you're not comfortable with them, you might find yourself kind of role-playing every potential reaction that your member is going to have. And I'll say, that's not going to do anything for your own stress, unfortunately. And then it's also, I would suggest taking a different approach rather than having a script ready for any occasion. Instead, think about how you yourself can be in a mentally calm, like solid foundation kind of a place, so that you can respond to their reaction, whatever it may be, to say, you know what, they're allowed to have their emotions. That is totally fine. I'm here to support them through that. And, you know, we're both going to be okay. That gives you much more flexibility and much more kind of a firmer stance. Instead, I would suggest thinking about, again, going back to these personality types, depending on their type and your type, I would suggest thinking about like what kind of reaction are they likely to have? Like, do they need to be reassured that they're not going to be fired? Do they need to ask a million questions to thoroughly understand the situation? Do they need something else? And think about maybe instead like categories of like, okay, I'm sensing that they need reassurance here. So that's what I'm going to deliver, or, you know, following their lead. Essentially, they're asking me a million questions, so I'm going to have the patience to answer those questions. So think instead about your personality types and again, the kind of reaction rather than a specific script. Right. The best way to wrap up a tough conversation is to connect it to the future. So have a wrap up with a positive, joint kind of collaborative plan for next steps. You've thoroughly talked through everything, your challenges, what does success look like? What does a solution look like? You're not spending a ton of time here, hopefully bogged down in the problem itself. Again, not ignoring it, but not getting bogged down in it either. You want to move as quickly as you can without being dismissive or not supportive. You want to be focusing on the solution so that you're not, again, backsliding and getting bogged down. You want to be talking about how you can support them to be successful, you know, confirm that relationship is still there and still strong. Even, you know, something got a mistake was made, but, you know, I'm still here for you. We're going to figure this out together. All right. Hopefully the conversation goes well and you're able to move quickly into a solution mode. But if not, that's perfectly normal. Sometimes there's a little bit more work to be done in the meantime. Denial, I have found, comes in two types, mainly. Either it's not that big a deal, or that's not what happened. So if you get it's not that big a deal, you want to go back to your natural consequences. You were unprepared and late. It caused delays and confusion and stress for your teammates, right? Like, spend more time in that if you're getting this kind of denial. Or if you get that's not what happened, spend a little time or make sure you come into that conversation with some specific documentation, specific dates that they were late, the amount of time that they were late. You know, you want to make sure you're not debating the facts. And if this gets difficult, this is one where you might get a you said, they said situation. You might want to utilize a neutral person to talk with your supervisee. They can help more quickly get to an established set of facts and reality of the situation, rather than you guys debating and spending a ton of time on it. A neutral person might be able to help them get there faster. So definitely use that as a resource. Once you have your facts established, then you move on to a solution. Like we mentioned before, if we're talking about multiple offenses, make sure you're not still talking about the same thing every time. Make sure you're talking about the appropriate level. And then toughest of all, what if it's not necessarily a performance issue, but instead an issue of someone's attitude? And that's where a one situation where a more indirect and sensitive question is better. So don't say, your attitude is a real problem. What are you going to do about it? It's a great direct question. But it's probably not going to work as well as, you know, I've noticed you're not your usual self. Is everything okay? And use that to open a more supportive conversation. You might have to push a little bit. People's walls can be kind of high, especially if they're struggling. So it might take a few conversations and repeated reassurance from you to actually get through on an attitude issue. But that's okay. That's the work. That's totally normal. All right. A quick detour into burnout. Bear in mind that motivation, engagement, stress, attitude, these things are all very closely linked. It's rare that someone is exhibiting a negative attitude because they're a bad person. It's usually because of the interplay between these factors. Stress in the workplace or in the personal life can easily derail their flow and have this ripple effect. And I will say times are plenty stressful at the moment with COVID and with other things. So something especially to be on the lookout this year. And you want to make sure, again, like if you put all the onus on them, like your attitude is poor. Like you are not, you know, you're not acknowledging that to them, like they're behaving in a way that feels logical, at least to them. It's a logical reaction to their environment that they're in. And so if you say you're wrong because you have a bad attitude, like you're not actually tapping into what to them feels like the deeper roots of the issue. So if you want to actually have a shift in someone's attitude, you need to have a conversation about their working environment. So burnout and attitude are related, but not exactly the same thing. But I do want to acknowledge that burnout is a lot more common than we would really like to talk about. I don't know anyone in nonprofits who's really comfortable talking openly and freely about their own struggles with burnout, despite the fact that it's a huge proportion of us that do feel burnout, at least occasionally. I think it is unfortunately kind of a natural product of nonprofit culture. It can be really, really toxic and be really hard to deal with. So instead of thinking about judging each other or feeling like it's not okay to talk about, a bit of understanding and support from you as a supervisor can go a long way to helping your supervisee deal with burnout, which might be contributing to a difficulty with their attitude. So some examples of causes of these underlying roots are, again, this is their perception. It may not be the literal reality, but this is what someone is feeling. It might be feeling that they're not really accepted or treated fairly at work. Their workload is crushing. They spend every day in a haze of confusion about what they're actually supposed to be doing. They aren't feeling connection and support from you as much as they would like, or maybe there's, you know, things are happening way more quickly than they can really handle. It's important to consider those things. Again, it may not be the reality. You may need to, provide more information and greater context so they can see a bigger picture, or they might be right. Like they may really be struggling and may really need some support and some tweaking from you. Let's see. So I will say as well that really think about the fact that burnout and this type of negative attitude is rarely just one person. If it's severe enough to lead to burnout, it's probably not just them. Others are probably walking along that same path. They're just at a different spot. They might not be as far along. So they're still better at kind of like keeping their problems to themselves. Or they might not have even recognized yet the signs of burnout or maybe an attitude problem in themselves. Like they are perhaps still a little bit in denial about how much they're actually struggling. Or they might be so far along in the process that essentially they're like, it's not worth it. Nothing's ever going to change. So why talk about it? So just to say, as a supervisor, it's important to really consider the systemic underlying causes and not just dismiss it as, well, this one person is not able to cope. So it's really their problem. It's not my problem. It's not the best way to go. Instead, you want to examine these deeper factors that are contributing to their burnout and make that good faith effort to actually address them. It's really scary. You don't necessarily want to open this can of worms, but the more you can normalize it for yourself and for your supervisees, the more likely you can actually make a meaningful change. And though difficult, you'll be glad that you did. Okay. So this is my second to last slide, almost there. This whole presentation I've talked about our need as a supervisor to really put ourselves out there and to push yourself as far as you can to be the best supervisor you can be and the best support you can be for your supervisees. But that strong supervision does start with a strong foundation and yourself being in a good place to start with. So as a supervisor, make sure to acknowledge that. Make sure to advocate for your own well-being too, not just your supervisees. Forgive yourself if you're starting to feel burnout. And do always have an optimistic eye for changes that you can make for your own self-care. Getting to know your own style, having a vocabulary to express strengths and things that you're struggling with can be very empowering, and it can give you a roadmap for your own growth as a professional overall, and as a supervisor in particular. Again, forgive yourself, but also forgive others as well. We're all on a journey. Have patience with yourself, have patience with others too, as much as you can. A little bit goes a long way. I think going back to our thought exercise, I feel like a lot of the best supervisor you ever had, mental picture, I bet a part of that was my supervisor was really patient with me. And maybe occasionally like forgave some of the smaller things. Like you felt like you had a safe space with them. So though it's, you know, that's work probably. I doubt that came naturally to them. And so make sure also that you're actively pursuing forgiveness and patience in your own supervision style. Actively seek out your support system, give yourself time to rest and to process things, but make sure that you are not isolated and that you still have these connections and these supports. Invest in yourself in the same way that you invest in your supervisees. See each challenge as that you run into or thing that you feel uncomfortable with or that feels painful to have to get through. See it as another road sign on your roadmap of life, leading you towards being stronger as a professional and a supervisor. And then, of course, take some time to actually give yourself the credit and acknowledgement that you deserve, right? Like, don't just focus on challenges. Also think to yourself, wow, I did a great job with that. Like, this is, look at everything that I brought to the table. Like, look at the impact this has had on my work and on my supervisee. Like, make sure you're giving equal attention and weight to the positive and hopeful things as much as you can. It shouldn't all just be this thought spiral of things that went wrong. None of it's easy, but it's work worth doing, truly, truly. And just know, of course, that you are not alone on this road of sometimes being successful and sometimes being challenged and sometimes maybe flubbing it. Like, I would say almost all the supervisors I know are along this road with you. So you've got plenty of company, even if you don't know it, and reach out to your fellows to get that support, because it makes all the difference. So that's it for our session today. On your screen, you can see a list of the books and resources that I have found to be very helpful in finding my own footing as a supervisor and as someone who coaches other supervisors. So check these out if you'd like more information. I hope you'll join us for the live discussion and in the discussion board, where we'll get into more of these different personality styles and how to apply some of these concepts in a more nuanced way for your own particular style and your supervisee's particular style. So we will be using those supervision lens, but again, there's lots of ways that this approach can enrich your relationships in the workplace and outside of the workplace. So I think it'll be great. Hope to see you there. But in the meantime, thanks for your time and your attention today, and have a great rest of your week.